Well, we're at the Hermitage here at a Duel presentation in Nashville, Tennessee on 1 September 2018, 12 noon Central Time.
Whatsoever. Well, a duel has three defining characteristics, and the first one is probably the most significant. The issue of social class. This is very much a class privilege. You have to be a gentleman to get away with this. If the baker and the butcher attempt to settle their differences this way, they're almost certainly going to hang for it for breaching the social boundaries. In other words, this is very much a rich man's game. And the second thing, you have to do this to the right sort of cause. These are often referred to as affairs of honor. That's the concept they're fighting over. But that can be a bit of a disconnect between their society and ours, because we don't really operate in an honor-based system anymore. And we have another institution in our modern society that sort of mirrors the purpose that honor had in the 19th century. Now, it probably sounds absurd to you when I say it, bear with me. It's mass communications. Now think about it. Let's say back then I want to get a loan to start a business, or I want to run for political office. How exactly are you going to figure out the nature of my character? You can't just procure a credit rating to find my financial history. You can't just run a background check on me. No, I'm prostrate before my reputation. Because you're either going to go around town and ask questions, or you're going to ask me for letters of recommendation, and then you're going to follow through on those. The kind of questions you'll ask are something like this. Is this guy honest? Does he keep his word? Does he pay his debts and on time? Is he courageous or is he cowardly? And if you're not getting good answers to questions like that when they're asked about you, well, you can probably forget about being able to do any kind of serious business in that town, being able to wield even the lowest of political office. So when I say that a young man is fighting to defend his honor, I quite literally mean he's fighting to defend his potential income and status in this society. Now the third thing, you have to do this to an intricate set of rules. Gentlemen are not supposed to just rush off into fights impulsively. They're expected to be able to regulate their emotions and govern their own behavior. And that's what this code is trying to get them to do. It's called the code duello. Or in other words, the dueling code. Alright, so we're going to proceed further today. Clearly, I'm going to need a sparring partner. So who would like to shoot a gun at me today? Come on up. So what's your name?
Madison.
Madison, well thank you for volunteering. And it's not too difficult. I'll tell you what to do. Just stay right here. I'll be right back. So, if myself and Madison are going to have an altercation today, we're going to need a good reason to do so. That's why I have brought the handy dandy insult generator. Ta-da! Inside this thing, we have some authentic 19th century insults, some of which are rather colorful. Who would like to help us start a fight by figuring out what she said or did? All you have to do is draw a thing out of a hat. Now, you don't read it out loud, but you get a preview. You can share it with people around you if you want to. And after you have finished enjoying it, just hand it back to me, and we'll get this started. Ridiculous. Alright, I'll explain to you what that means, sir. Rivalry already brewing between the two of us, and One day, we both happened to be in town when an exchange like this would occur. Sir, I have it on rather good authority that you've been publicly referring to me as a loco foco. Sir, you should be aware that such assaults upon my political reputation must demand satisfaction, sir. You know where to find me, don't you? You have a pleasant day. So, what just happened right there? Now, despite the icy, forced politeness, the fighting words 200 years ago, you called me a loco foco. Now, if you're wondering what that is a contemporary political movement of this time. It's sort of a fringe group. And as I am not flattered to be associated with them, I'm interpreting this as an insult. So if I allow this to stand, people are going to make one of two assumptions about me. Either one, that I am a part of the loco foco party, or two, that I'm just too cowardly to stand up and defend my political reputation when it's being publicly slandered. And either one of those are intolerable to me as a gentleman. So I feel an enormous amount of social pressure to confront her about it. So I did. I confirmed she said it. And at that point, I asked her if she wanted to fight. But you might have missed that part, because I didn't make it terribly obvious when I did it. I didn't say anything to her like, you want to fight, you want to duel. And the reason you don't do that is because publicly challenging someone to fight you, that can be construed as breaching the peace. That's an offense against the law. We don't want the authorities getting involved in this and making it more complicated. We also don't want commoners to be able to understand what we're saying, because this is a privileged conversation between gentlemen. So therefore, we use a coded language. Make sure only those who are in the know are invited. And the key word to know this was satisfaction. Every gentleman knows exactly what that word means. But I demand satisfaction from her. She knows. I want physical combat over this insult. But that word does have the added benefit, where if I do happen to get hauled to court for this, I could always just say, but Your Honor, this is not the kind of satisfaction that I was referring to on that occasion. As you can see, it's a pretty clever word that you can use to protect yourself in a situation like this. Now, she has the option to accept or to refuse my challenge, but considering she's made this rather public insult towards me, how is she going to look in the eyes of her peers now if she refuses? Have she looked weak, exactly. Like someone who can insult someone, but when that insult comes on the roof, she backs down. Yeah, it'll make her look like a coward. So she is also under an enormous amount of social pressure to behave in a certain fashion. She does what any gentleman would have done to preserve their reputation. She accepted. I do want to stress that does not mean violence between us is inevitable now. It isn't. On a certain level, this is still just a heightened verbal altercation. We can still talk our way through this peacefully at this stage. But something could occur between us that would make violence inevitable. Something considered an unforgivable sin among gentlemen. That is a physical strike. If one of us were to lose our temper, he'll lay hands on the other in any way, including the infamous glove slap that you might have seen before. Well, the rules are clear about what would have to happen. We would be compelled to settle the issue over shots on the field. Guaranteed, there's no talking your way out of that kind of situation. And then once that were settled, assuming we were left standing, which is a big assumption, then we potentially have to fire shots again over the entire loco foco affair. And yes, it can get that complicated. So to keep it from getting to that point in the first place, the code Duelo steps in and starts regulating our behavior. And the first thing that it asks is that the moment the challenge is accepted, commands us to immediately separate. We're no longer allowed to be in the same room anymore. We can't even have written correspondence. And that is the code Duelo, taking that temptation for escalation out of our hands, so that way we don't keep insulting each other, pushing each other's buttons, until we want to hit each other. But then that puts us into a bit of a dilemma. If we can't have any kind of direct communication, how exactly are we going to set this whole thing up? What would you do if you had to plan an event with someone that you can't speak to? How would you do that? Arbitrator, phone a friend. That's what we're doing. We're going to find peers of equal social standing to arbitrate for us. And these guys will hopefully bring calmer voices in this heated argument. They're serving a role here similar to attorneys, or diplomats, in a gentleman's game. And like some folks in the audience, I think already know the answer, you would be referring to these people as seconds. You refer to us as the principals, or in other words, the primary fighters. So clearly, we need some representation up here, don't we? So, we get a couple seconds from the audience. Volunteer. You got one? You got two. Come on up. Alright, so this can be my second then. And then what's your name, sir? Well, thank you for volunteering. You can be her second. So, So, the normal part of what these seconds we try to achieve here would be a peaceful settlement, one that doesn't resort to violence. Hopefully, they're a good friend of ours. Like, you can get through this whole situation alive. If you want to know a good example of someone in history who is masterful at using this process of seconds to achieve peace, then I would look at Alexander Hamilton. Now, Hamilton has certainly achieved a good deal of fame for himself here lately, thanks to the musical. And I'm willing to bet that pretty much all of you are already aware of his duel with Aaron Burr, the most famous duel in American history. But I'm also willing to bet that most of you aren't aware of his other 12, because he issued or accepted a total of 13 challenges. And yes, that's a ludicrously high number. But it's what you have to keep in mind about it, though. He only actually ended up fighting on the dueling field, pistol in hand. One of those, the one with Burr. And he was able to get out of it so often because he was a masterful negotiator. He used his process of seconds to talk his way out of violence before he got to the dueling field almost every single time. So I do want you to realize it's a very important part of this whole thing. But I sort of doubt that any of you came here today to see aggressive negotiations for peace, did you? So, considering that, let's talk about how the terms of combat will be negotiated to our seconds. Terms being time and place, weapons and distance. Now, first of all, it would not be fair for me, the person who issued this challenge to begin with, to be able to dictate those terms to my opponent. If you could simultaneously challenge somebody to tell them exactly how you're gonna fight, why wouldn't a bully go around and challenge people they think are unskilled with a particular weapon, but then they can pick them off and have an elevated reputation of themselves? Now, to keep that kind of predatory behavior from happening, and also to just keep some young hothead from rushing into these things without thinking too much about it, you put a check on your power here as a challenger to make you more reluctant. Because in this system, when you challenge somebody else, you give your opponent the right to set all the terms of combat, which means you would get to set them all here. Now, I hope you don't mind, for the sake of expediency, if we just do this right here, right now. You got the time? Awesome. And we may as well do the standard weapon and standard distance of this time and place, and that would have been pistols at 10 paces. So, she needs to communicate this to me, doesn't she? But like I mentioned earlier, she can't just come up to me and say it. She can't even write a letter and tell me. So let's recreate how she might try to relay that information. So, in this situation, we're going to be at our estates, and this is going to represent the middle of town. And eventually, our second will have to ride into town to talk about the terms. My second, I just need you to find out what the terms are. You're not to accept or to refuse on my behalf just yet. It's not new, bring it to me. And you're just gonna say, pistols at 10 paces, okay? All right, so seconds, giddy up. Here, have a brandy, that must've been a long trip. What are the terms? Pistols at 10 paces, seriously. I should have expected as much from someone lacking in imagination. No. Now go tell them that we are willing to accept their challenge.
We are willing to accept your challenge.
Just finish the bottle. But now you have to tell her. Oh, right. So, you might have noticed something about that. How incredibly time-consuming that would have actually been, too. Because in reality, you're not just walking a couple of feet. And that simple exchange right there, that could have taken an entire day or two of communication. By the time all the negotiations are finished, it could potentially be weeks before we can actually arrive on the field. Well, this whole process is deliberately engineered to be this tedious. You're not supposed to just challenge somebody in the morning, and then go and fight them in the evening. That would be considered somewhat improper. And they're purposefully drawing out these negotiations to give these young men ample opportunity to calm down. They don't want them just rushing into these things headstrong. They want them to be able to rationalize their own mortality. And hopefully this gives them the time, on an emotional level, to be capable of doing that. Alright, so, for those of you who came here today expecting to see the Hollywood version of this, you might be disappointed. Have you ever seen a duel in the movies?
No.
It's not too difficult, I'll show you what to do. Alright, let's come out here. Alright, go ahead and cock your pistol. There you go. Now, point it up in the air like that, and step back to back with me. Oh, with me. Back to back with me. All right. So we've all seen it, right? This is in the air, back to back. And then a voice of narration, in this case, the audience, starts counting from 1 to 10, if you will.
Five, six, seven, eight, nine.
little bit close to each other. I think the actual moving distance would look more like, stop, more like this. Now, I want you to keep this distance that we're at right now. Keep this image burned in the back of your head. I want you to remember just how far away this is. Because I have some bad news for the romantics among you. That never happened. What you just saw is complete fiction. It's based on the actual research I'm dealing with from the experts I know. They cannot find a single instance in history where it was ever done in that fashion. No, that's pure theatrics. Terrified Hollywood looked good for you on the screen. And Hollywood is all, so to speak. And it does look good on the screen. But it's not that this was actually done. So therefore, we're going to go ahead and show you the historical method here today, at least for this time and place. You'll find it's direct and potentially even more dramatic than that. So, let's get to it. Let's assume at this point all negotiations for peace between us have failed. What'll happen? I'm going to show up with my second on my side of the field at the pre-designated time. You'll do the same. And this is the first time that we've been allowed to see each other or be near each other since our altercation. And even though we can very plainly hear each other right now, we're still not allowed to talk directly. We must still communicate through our seconds. Speaking of which, the code gives us one last chance to get out of this without having to resort to violence to do it. So, the seconds would meet in the middle of the field. And I want you to ask my second, can this not be peacefully reconciled?
No, this cannot be peacefully reconciled.
All right. So, when that question is raised, if either party were to say no, we can't settle this peacefully, well, the rules are clear. Now, you must proceed to a fire before you're allowed to negotiate 16. Again. So, on that exchange that just happened there, we have for the first time okay. locked ourselves into combat. Now, we have to fight.
I understand.
So, at this point, the field is prepared. So, mark is put down. And then, usually a second would mark off the paces, but I'm going to go ahead and do this for expediency's sake.
2 minutes.
The literature states each pace should be about 3 feet. So, it's going to look like this.